extravagances of the houses frequently led to bankruptcy. However small their wages, the armies of servants had to be maintained. The estates themselves, vast though they were, suffered from the neglect of the absentee landlords. The Blake family first came to the shores of Galway Bay with the Norman invasion. They built their big house at Ardfry. Only the ruins exist there now. The servants, like the family, are dispersed, but the bell that once summoned them from the fields can still be chimed in his place over the old forge. Lila is the eldest sister of three.
My grandfather married a second time, and I'm afraid he married a gambler. And she gambled every penny that she could from the place. Therefore, it was left to get into the ruin you see it now. She sold bits and pieces. She sold the roof, the floors, the fireplaces. Well, she sold everything. She was going to sell this, only there happened to be some tenants here who managed to prevent that, and then she died before she had time to wreck the whole place.
With her two sisters, June and Jane, they are the present representatives of the Blake family line. They were born in England, on the Isle of Wight, and not till late in life did they inherit what was left of the family estate and settle in Ireland. The Blakes have lived here in Galway for almost 800 years, and the family tree can be traced back through Lord Walscourt of Ardfry, back to the Plantagenets, to Henry III, King of England. There was even a saint in the family, Saint Ferdinand, King of Spain. But the sisters today, what do they feel themselves to be?
British.
Mm.
Half and half.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, can you see if our mother's sort of half Irish?
Mummy's mother was English, and Mummy's father was Irish.
Irish.
Service in the British Army is a family tradition.
His father was Irish, and his father before him was Irish.
An ancestor. The Honourable Fitzroy Henry Richard Stanhope, aide-de-camp to the Duke of Wellington.
And then our father was English, so we feel both. Our father was killed at the end of the First World War, the very end, 2 months before I was born, so I never saw him even. He was missing, actually. And to this day, we don't quite know how he died.
Sorry, Bishop.
May I borrow the cat basket? Cat
basket?
Oh, yes. Kim Marion, I think. You're in Ireland, remember?
Ardfry House was still standing when the three sisters returned, but their inheritance didn't amount to much. It was beyond repair.
No, we've never been able to live in the big house. We've lived up here, in this little place, which was the steward's house. The Steph's grandmother, she left it empty.
Mm.
And so everybody, you know what happens if a house is left empty. Well, they just came and just rampaged over everything and took everything back to Galway on boats and the chandeliers and the silver things and everything.
And for instance, that old piano we've got, that was found years afterwards in a barber shop in Galway.
That's why a lot of the papers and things have gone, so that's really why one can't tell you more about the sort of history of everything, because everything was all sort of ransacked.
We had nothing to do with it. We were completely in no possession of it whatsoever, were we?
No. It wasn't ours then, you
no,
see.
No, she didn't belong to us, so we couldn't do anything. Our grandfather died, you see.
Our mother couldn't do anything.
And Mummy couldn't do anything about it.
Oh, we were quite used to not having any money, actually. Mm.
Oh, yes, you had an awful time trying to have turkeys in the kitchen.
Anyway, from the money point of view, I mean, as I say, we were so used to not having much money.
We knew there wasn't any anyway.
I mean...
No, but this little bit that we had there, it had absolutely nothing, did it?
No.
Except the rooms. There was
nothing.
Not even a water tap.
Not a basin or to wash anything with.
No. So the first thing we had was to put a tank to get some water running into the house. Then the next year, we started getting a bathroom and a WC, because we only had an Elston, you see. And we were cooking on primer stoves and living on camp beds and, you know, when we were really just camping out. But anyway, we gradually progressed from there, and with the money we got from the land commission for the land that they'd taken, we built on a little bit on there. And then from the money we got from the selling our place in England, we built on this room and one or two places on there. But we gradually built it up, and we're all a very happy little community now, aren't we?
Yes.
The family fortune, long since squandered, heirlooms dispersed, and the ancestral home in ruins, but the sisters did at least inherit a family tradition, a love of horses.
Oh, I wish that you adore them. They're crazy on them, I'm afraid. But it is my absolute love. It always has been. Always been mad on horses. All my life. Well, we all have, I think. I suppose that's why one's always drawn them, because one's just sort of loved everything about them, even the smell of them. You've got to keep them in the stable all the time. That's terribly expensive. But ours aren't too bad because they're Connemaras, you see, and they're used to living out. We don't have to have them shod because they're all on the soft all the time.
Our mother adored our place. She was born here. And ever since we could remember, she told us all about it. Mm. And we just always longed to come to our place, you see. It was our one dream,
our dream to come here.
Yes. Mm. And we had this absolute picture of it. It was sort of absolute heaven to come here at last. And we loved it just as much as we always thought we would. And still do.
We didn't actually get it settled with the Land Commission and everything until 1950. So that's when we came and put our stake down again, wasn't it?
Oh, yes.
Well, when we actually managed to settle here properly was in May 1968. But before that, we'd only been able to come over in ribs and rep, you know, for sort of long holidays and things. It was when our mother died, you see. She was too old to dig up her roots in the Isle of Wight to really come and live here, you know. Well, we all adored her, and we didn't want to leave while she was still alive. And then when she died, we all just thought, well, we'll go to Ardfra straight away. Well, we certainly find plenty to pass our time.
Never a dull moment.
No, what do we do? Well, we both paint a little bit, Jane and I.
Oh, yes. We're marvelous artists.
No. Yeah, we do. But we've got horses and dogs, bands and geese, and we do some gardening. We try and do a bit of gardening.
You're a damn good artist, anyway.
Plants all the potatoes and keeps us supplied with potatoes.
Yes.
And we sweep the house and we feed the dogs and we feed the cats and we feed the bantams.
We certainly don't have a dull moment, anyway.
We're very happy. Very happy in a simple way. And we're an absolutely crazy family. As you can
already gathered.
Well, just completely unconventional, I'm afraid. Live and let live.
In fact, I don't know how anybody puts up with that, really.
I know. Amazing, isn't it? It's like sort of Shangri-La, isn't it, in a way? Mm. I think we're terribly lucky to have it. Mm. Poor man sitting, have you got anything to drink?
Seventy-five miles to the north, the noble brow of Ben Bulbon on the coast of County Sligo. The mystic mountain of Knocknarea that the poet Yeats celebrated. It was here in County Sligo that the first of the Gore Booths made a home in Ireland and acquired a vast estate in the 17th century. Years later, they remain at Lizardelle. The light of evening, Lizardelle. Great windows open to the south. Two girls in silk kimonos, both beautiful, one a gazelle. The two girls in kimonos admired by W.B. Yeats were the Gore Booth sisters, Eva and Constance, both beautiful. The one, a gazelle, Constance, turned against her family and her class. She became the rebel Countess Markievicz, one of the leaders of the Easter Rising of 1916. Later, she was the first woman to be elected to the British House of Commons. She never took her seat. She was in prison at the time on a charge of treason. Speak of that old Georgian mansion, mix pictures of the mind, recall that table and the talk of youth. Two girls in silk kimonos, both beautiful, one a gazelle. 70 years later, her niece and nephew are custodians of the big house. Aideen Gore Booth is the niece.
Well, I never forget the year I was born, which was 1916. And I had a very happy childhood here with three sisters and four brothers, which we were educated with the governess until I was 15. And then I went to school called Bromsbury in London. When that was over, the economic war came along, and my father at that time had over 100 people working in Lizardelle. And I think he was very hard-pressed, and he had to make a lot of personal economies. And I suppose this kind of sunk into me a little bit, and I asked if I could go and train as a Northern nurse, nursery nurse. I was very fond of children, which I did. And when I got there, I found it, to tell you the truth, very hard, because I'd always had a staff and I was very ham-fisted and everybody was laughing at me. I couldn't do anything right, but I got through it, and I was very glad I did, because it was a great foundation for the rest of my life, and I generally had to do all sorts of practical things, and also I had some nice jobs from it, which I enjoyed very much. I came back then to live here, and my father wasn't very strong. I used to nurse him, or help my sisters to nurse him. Then in the war, I worked out with my younger sister on the farm, and well, then one thing borrowed another, and I was just here, except for holidays, from that time on, I think.
A horse is borrowed, and her riding habit, a relic of old decency, and she finds the label of Anglo-Irish sits uneasily.
I hate labelling anybody. I think it's done so much in Ireland, and I think it's very stupid, because I think everybody is a person. It doesn't much matter who they are, what they are, but I did look at rather an amusing programme about the Anglo-Irish, She said they all had long noses and fond of sport, and I thought that rather described me, perhaps.
Aideen Gorbood accepts responsibility for his Adele. It's an old home in a damp climate. She relies on the money collected from visitors, whom she herself conducts on daily tours. Anyone who turns up will get a warm welcome from her.
Now, I'd like to say how very welcome you all are, and I hope you'll enjoy this little tour around our house and not be bored by it. There are two very strict rules.
Well, now, the foundations of this house were laid in 1830. It was actually occupied by my forebears in 1833. And the pictures in the gold Florentine frames, there are a whole lot in here. They were all collected on what was then called the Grand Tour of Southern Europe, which my great-grandfather did and brought back. As you can see, and I've now got a slight whisper that I'm getting a grant after 18 years to get. So I asked Lord Mountbatten, might I buy his curtains? And he said, oh no, certainly not. He said, I'll give them to you. And he gave them all to us. And his daughter fella popped up. So he put up his gun to shoot it, and the most awful thing happened, the trigger jammed. He thought the bear was just going to kill him. But luckily, Mr. And a very small American lady with a very strident voice came in. She looked at St. John the Baptist and these naked women. And then she said to me, are these all your ancestors? And I'm afraid I said, yes. Now, this room we call the bowed drawing room. It's so called, you see, because it's got a bowed window. But it also would be the room that the famous poet W.B. Yeats was thinking of in hindsight. When he wrote that poem that you may or may not know, which starts, the light of evening, listen. These are my two poor middle brothers, who very sad to say we lost in the last war. My third brother, Brian, went down in the Exmouth with all hands, doing convoy duty off the north of Scotland in January 1940. My second brother, Hugh, was posted missing, believed killed, in November 43, with the Royal Irish Fusiliers in Leros. And when the confirmation of his death came the following March, my father died 4 days afterwards.
We used to have wild games all through the house and put all the lights out and had tremendous fun at night. I think nothing in the house is perfect because we're a bit wild, you know. Must have been rather hard on the furniture.
Now, when I was a little girl living in this house many years ago with my brothers and sisters, there were 8 of us all together, it was the usual thing in those old days, if you were a child belonging to a house like this, to have your teacher living in the house with you. She was known as a governess. Would you have liked that, to have your teacher living in the house with you? No, of course you wouldn't. We didn't like it, but we had to put up with it. Now, over the mantelpiece is a large watercolour which shows my great-grandmother and great-aunts. Great-grandmother was the second wife of my great-grandfather, Sir Robert Gorbooth. Well, she's the one we're all descended from. Well, she could trace her ancestry right back to Brian Boru, the hero of Clontarf, so I must be connected with President Reagan.
Early in the 1930s, when economic relations between England and Ireland became tense, there was no English market for Irish agriculture. The Gorbooth family affairs took a turn for the worse. There was a large labour force and no income from the farm.
My father took 100 people in the estate over the economic war, which was absolutely unique in this country, by having a mortgage, and which he subsequently paid off, and also reducing, with the help of my mother, all his personal expenditure. And the late P.J. Rutledge said he deserved tremendous respect for this, that he was about the only person in Ireland who did this, because he told me himself that if anybody got the sack in those days, you see, there were no unemployment benefits, there was nothing like nowadays, and they just simply would have starved, so he manfully brought them over that time.
Are you all coming here, please?
Miss Gorbooth's father was generous and not typical, a landlord who cared for his tenants. His generosity was no protection for the estate. Miss Gorbooth recalls that after the death of her father, the house and the estate were taken out of the hands of the family. They were denied any control in the management. The episode still rankles.
It was all the Court of Chancery who did that. They'd cut the trees that were left to finance everybody's jobs, and also
My sister was a very sort of forward-looking person. She would have gone into modern practices and things like that, but she simply was not allowed to do it. She was put out of management, and we were told if we interfered in the estate, we could see everything that was going wrong, that my mother would be put out of the house.
The large paintings of George Daniels, they have suffered with deterioration. They could very easily be restored. I've only got enough money, but it would take an awful lot to do those particular ones. Now, here we have a white blackbird. Did you ever see a white blackbird? And the two little snipe, secretary bird from Africa. And here we have long-tailed duck. I'll ask you not to lean on the banisters or the railings. It's a very old house, and it makes me very frightened if some rather fat person leans against this one, because they popped out here, it wouldn't do, would it? Now, this room I'm going to look at also from the door is the room where the famous poet W.B. Yeats actually slept when he came here as a visitor. And that is what is known as a full test of four-poster bed and a full set of bedroom china. It's a complete set. None of it has been broken. Now, I wonder if I've got anybody from the north of Ireland in this party. But I have a very naughty story I tell them to cheer them up. Would you like to hear it? Well, it's about two poor nuns. You see, there were two poor nuns who were rather like me. They were absent-minded, and they went on a motoring trip and ran out of petrol. But they had a very long walk to the pump. The man had lots of petrol, but nothing to put it in. Then he suddenly bethought himself that he had a chamber pot. So he filled the chamber pot up with petrol, and the nuns trotted back to the car. Well, they were just busy pouring it in when who came by but the Reverend Ian Paisley. He looked at them in astonishment. He said, I hate your religion, but I cannot but admire your faith. Now, you all come this way, please. It's rather nice to be part of the country and doing something and helping on tourism, and I always like to be part of everything, you know. The bed and breakfast people like having us. It's a help to them, and I think the tourist board in Sligo like having us. And you know, there's so many stupid things going on. It's nice to feel you're doing something useful, isn't it? Well, now, good people, that, I'm afraid, is the end of the tour with me. And thank you very much for your kind support. And I'm always hoping there'll be a millionaire in the party. And the next day I get a big check to restore everything, which you never know. And if you're leaving me now, you may go down and see the old kitchen past the bear. Somebody else looks after you down there. I just think of myself as a poor little creature trying to live. I don't think of myself as anything particular. I think it's very hard to say, really. One doesn't know. I mean, I always thought of myself as Irish when I was young, but then we were so badly treated, I didn't know what to think. I think everything to do in life is just to face it and make the best of it. And generally, then you come out all right.